target homeless people. So you don't get services and you get targeted to be arrested. I wanted to read a story that I think a lot of people could probably relate to, which was in Little Rock, Arkansas. Homeless persons have reported being kicked out of the bus stations in Little Rock, even when they had valid bus tickets. Two homeless men reported that officers of the Little Rock Police Department in separate incidences had kicked them out of Little Rock bus station, even after showing their police tickets. In other instances, homeless persons have been told that they could not wait at the bus station because you are homeless. Let's see, in Atlanta, Georgia, they target homeless people who were the Katrina evacuees, refugees, and they put a ban on supportive housing inside the city limits. And there's a lot of Las Vegas, which is just a very bad place for homeless people and target homeless people at any public places. And the mayor there says that if you want to push him, he'll show you what he means by basically arresting homeless people. So those are, and what we've seen is that cities are only, what this report shows is that cities are only increasing in ordinances. When you begin an ordinance, it doesn't get better. It only gets worse. It only continues to target homeless people. And it moves the middle class people further away from people experiencing homelessness. So it only continues that divide. It does nothing to bond it, nothing to create relationships or understanding, but just further divide. We've learned that all of these ordinances violate basic civil rights under the Constitution. And if you'd like to know more about that, I can pass around the paper. When we do the second half solutions, I would like to show you what other cities have done instead of working against homeless people, what they have done to bring people who are homeless, experience homelessness, cities, organizations together and collaborate and only experience positiveness towards working with homeless people instead of obviously working against them. It was explaining this to my five-year-old, it was pretty simple for him to get. But if you went to the city ordinance, it was a complete, there was no connection there between what is it to work with people instead of working against them and targeting them. So I just wanted to share that, and I hope, I don't want to take any more time telling my personal story unless there's time at the end about what it is like to experience homelessness or the threat of homelessness or what the definitions are. But what I've learned is that through the course of the year of not having housing and using resources and finding out there are not a lot of resources out there to help you find housing, which is the number one problem for me. And that I hope that we get to learn about what it's like to live on the street and what people who live on the street, what respect they would like from other people who don't live on the street, what the city ordinance would do to them by kicking them out of the city. I hope that we get to learn about different perspectives of being homeless for whatever your case is, living in someone else's house, going from place to place. I didn't quite print off the definition of homeless. But maybe we can hear other different experiences and learn what you would like, how you would like to be treated and how the ordinances would affect you.
We also, there's one other definition, living in substandard housing is
If other people have definitions or ways to explain their definition of homelessness, so I'm not, I'm only an expert, but I've experienced.
Substandard can also consider an emotionally haphazard environment.
Yes.
And I'm seeing more components of that that are helping.
So now we're just going to open it up and really want to hear from people who have experienced or are experiencing homelessness, you know, some of the things that Amanda
54 years old, and I've been homeless at two different, I'm not homeless right now, I've never been sleeping. We keep threatening to throw them out, so I don't have any money, but I've worked it out so far. They told me to come, they said, oh, well, you know, don't worry about it. Come live here. Don't worry about your financial aid. You know, you don't have enough, and they say, oh, no, you have to go. It's okay as long as the phone is going to start harassing me about money. I'm okay. We're going to get a tax refund and it's going to pay for last quarter for the stuff I still owe. So I'm waiting for this quarter. I'll work it out somehow because I'm very persuasive. There's a lot of everything that students are homeless. It's over 10%. The college students.
You did say 2% of the students are homeless?
Only to over 10%, according to the survey that I saw.
Is that at Evergreen?
Yes. Yeah. And a very high percentage of low income. I'm not sure what the percentage is. I'm going to find out. I'm working right now on things like trying to get the college to accept food stamps at their store, because they don't. I'm maybe trying to get some other programs for low-income students. I think that's all I have to
there, say. Yeah, is there anything you want the community to know about?
I want them to know that there are a lot of people who are homeless because their employment runs out, or because the place they were living gets scary for some reason, or because, I don't know, people who are living paycheck to paycheck, it's easy for them to have medical expenses. You know, it's like people like to tell themselves that they're very different from homeless people that they're not. Yeah. Anybody, you know, almost anybody can have.
Before you sit down.
Yes.
How can we help?
No, that's the second part.
That's the second part?
Yeah.